Hey guys, and welcome back to another video from The Modern Vet. My name is Dr. Armstrong, and today I'm going to be reviewing three vet prep questions for the NAVLE. Recently, you guys found out whether you passed or did not pass the NAVLE exam. For those who didn't pass, trust me, no worries at all, because there's always next time and you will get it. It's just practice, 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 and do not let that exam make you feel like you will never become what you set out to be, because you will. So just keep practicing, give it another go, and I promise you, you will be successful the next time, even if it takes three more attempts. All right, it doesn't matter, you're gonna get it and you're gonna get to where you wanna go. Let's begin. A three-year-old female spayed indoor-outdoor domestic short hair presents for congestion and swelling over the bridge of the nose. The swelling over the nose is firm and seems to be subcutaneous. There is also mild enlargement of the mandibular lymph nodes. You perform cytology from a fine needle aspirate of the swelling over the nose and see narrow, budding, thick-walled yeast surrounded by clear capsules. You also detected a lesion in the retina on fundic examination. Which of the following treatments would be indicated? Amoxicillin clavulanic acid, doxycycline, itraconazole, lufenuron, or trimethoprim sulfam. Okay guys, so here we have this signalment, which is that of a cat, all right, fairly young. Indoor, outdoor, okay. Now it presents for some swelling and congestion, and the swelling is located over the bridge of the nose. All right, definitely something to note, okay? So we also are told that in addition to the swelling that's found upon the bridge of the nose, there's also enlarged lymph nodes, submandibular lymph nodes that can be appreciated on exam. Now they tell you, you do the FNA and you see this. You see budding yeast, they're encapsulated, and they just look pretty classic for a type of fungus that we should have learned about, okay? So let's just say you're looking at this image and you're like, all right, regardless of where the lesion was found, they show me this picture, and it's obviously not bacteria, okay? It's not cocci, it's not rods, it's this, right? And they even describe it for you. They use the words budding and yeast, encapsulated, right? So those descriptions should be enough for you to know, even if you're not all that good at cytology, that this is not a bacterium. This is some sort of yeast or fungal organism. So those are the clues that they give you. Then they tell you that there's a lesion in the fundic exam. So why is that important? We have this fungal organism that is responsible for this lesion of the nose, and it's probably, we don't know for sure, but it's probably responsible for the lesion in the eye. And the reason why I say probably is because we didn't perform any diagnostics to know for sure that it's connected. We've only information from the nose because of the fine needle aspirate of the nose. So what we know for sure, as far as our data is concerned, is that we have this lesion of the nose that is fungal in origin from the fine needle aspirate. We have enlarged lymph nodes, so something systemic is going on, okay? Then we see the lesion in the eye. So we can probably surmise that it's connected as far as lesion in the eye, but regardless, clock is ticking, we have this image of a fungal organism that's causing lesions in the body. And now they're asking us, they're not asking us what is this organism, they're asking us what are you going to treat it with. So in order to know what you're going to treat it with, you have to know what kind of organism it is. Now looking at our options for the answer choices, we see the first one is an antibiotic, the amoxicillin clavulanic acid. Say that 5 times fast, because sometimes I trip over the clavulanic, I can't even say it. Amoxicillin clavulanic acid. So we know that is a commonly prescribed antibiotic. Antibiotics are used to treat bacterial infections, not fungal infections. So immediately we just knock that off our options, okay? The next one is doxycycline. Again, that is an antibiotic. It is not used to treat fungal infections, so we're gonna knock that off our list. The third option is itraconazole. That one, for sure, we know is an antifungal agent. And just as a little shortcut, if you're not entirely sure, do remember that majority of the medications, keyword majority of the medications that end in azoles are typically used to treat fungal infections, okay? So itraconazole is used to treat fungal infections. So is that my answer? I'm gonna put a question mark and a little check next to it because I'm convinced that's what it is, but I do have a few more to go. So the fourth one is one that I personally have never heard of, which is lufenuron. And I'm probably gonna put a question mark next to that, but I know I've never heard of it. It's probably nothing, it probably has nothing to do with this organism. So put a question mark, but more than likely it's no. Then the last one is mifepristone sulfa. So again, that is an antibiotic. Trimethoprim sulfa, doxycycline, and amoxiclav are three antibiotics that we should know right off the top of our head. And we know that those do not treat fungal infections. So bye. Now the other one, lufenuron, that one again, I haven't heard of, maybe you have, but I know for sure that lufenuron compared to itraconazole is not it. Itraconazole, remember azoles, are used to treat fungal infections. So that is my answer, okay? So really for this question, you don't really have to go into the whole indoor outdoor thing and this and that, and you know, the lesion was here, there. It's important, don't get me wrong. However, look at what they're asking you and look at the overwhelming information they presented. The overwhelming information is in the image, and they use that image to say, this is your clue. What is this in the image? And based on the answer choices, what are you gonna use to treat what you see here? So you say, all right, they could be talking about a dog, they could be talking about a cat with a broken neck, it doesn't matter. They're just saying this image is a fungal organism. What do you use to treat fungal organisms, right? Fungal infections. You use medications that end, for the most part, in azole. So itraconazole is the drug of choice. Okay, I hope that makes sense. Next question. A 2-year-old male neutered cat presents to you depressed, hypersalivating, and ataxic with muscle tremors. The owner reports that a pyrethrin-based spot-on formulation for flea control belonging to their golden retriever was accidentally applied on the cat earlier today. Which of the following drugs will you use to treat the cat's clinical signs? This is one of those things where, unfortunately, you just gotta know. When it comes to toxicology, one of the main ones that we're taught outside of grapes and raisins and chocolates and things like that is that pyrethrin-based drugs that are used to, you know, as far as flea and tick preventatives in dogs should never, ever be used in cats. We also know that whenever they are used in cats, majority of the time it is accidental, okay? So owners don't mean to use it knowing that it is toxic. They either pick it up saying, oh, if it's safe in my dog, I surely can use it in my cat. Or they pick it up by accident when they meant to pick up something else, okay? So anytime you hear anything having to do with pyrethrin and cats, just know that it is a pyrethrin toxicity, and with all the muscle spasms and the ataxia and the hypersalivation, basically the question is asking, which of the following drugs will you use to treat the cat's clinical signs? Now this question is asking, so the cat comes in hypersalivating, it's ataxic, and it has muscle tremors because we have a toxic principle, you know, attacking the neuromuscular component of the animal's body, okay? So going through these drug choices, let's see which would be the most appropriate given the cat's clinical signs. So atropine is an option, that's their first option. Amoxicillin, second option. Acepromazine is our third option. Tupam is the fourth, and methocarbamol is the fifth. Clock is ticking, you're going through these and you're just like, oh my goodness, I don't even know where to begin. Let's just start with what you think, briefly in your head, could be the right thing to do as far as controlling the cat's clinical signs. So it's depressed, are we really gonna find a drug to cure depression? No. Is it, you know, it's hypersalivating? Are we gonna do something to try to stop the hypersalivation? Not so much. I mean, that's not the biggest thing that we need to worry about, right? Depressed mentation is also not the biggest thing we need to worry about. For me, as I'm reading this question, I'm not concerned with finding a drug to cure depression, or I should say depressed state of mind or mentation. I'm not concerned with finding a drug that's gonna stop the hypersalivation. So let me look to see what the other clinical signs are that they gave. Ataxia. Okay, yeah, that's something that is definitely important to keep in mind. Okay, I don't want this cat to just be stumbling around ataxic forever. But then muscle tremors. Now if you can imagine, the cat's literally like, you know, jolting and shivering and tremoring. And so that consumes a lot of oxygen, a lot of energy, and it's tiring, right? And which doctor would feel comfortable watching an animal just tremor, like having mini, you know, like micro seizures of the muscles. So of those four clinical signs that they gave, I personally, and I hope you too, would be most concerned with finding something that would control the muscle tremors. Because number one, again, oxygen consumption, energy consumption. And then as you can also imagine, when the muscles are constantly working like this, what's gonna happen to the temperature? It's gonna get driven up. So I don't want my patient to become hyperthermic as a result of these constant muscle tremors. So I'm gonna look at my answer choices and pick the one that would be most appropriate for what I'm concerned with the most, which is the muscle tremors. So I'm looking at atropine. I have no reason to pick this drug because it didn't say anything about bradycardia. And could it help with the hypersalivation? Sure, but is that my biggest concern? No, so I'm not gonna look at that as a consideration. The next one is amoxicillin. We know that amoxicillin is an antibiotic. Nothing about this screams that we need to have antimicrobial therapy, so just keep it moving, okay? Don't even think twice about that one. Acepromazine. Now that's fair, right? Because you're probably gonna be thinking, well, it is a sedative, tranquilizer, it could help relax the cat, but okay, fine. If you're using it to relax the cat with hopes that it's gonna stop the muscle tremors, is it really going to stop the, is that, you know, so it could, but is it really going to? I would probably pick it if that's literally the best option of the bunch, but I'm only in my third option, I have two more to go, so I'll just put a question mark, because, you know, if that's all you had, you could technically use it and see what happened. But let's just keep going through the answer choices and see if that is the best drug to use, okay? So then our next option is TUPAM. Now, probably gonna be one of two people during the exam. You're probably gonna be one who knows exactly what TUPAM's used for, is used as sort of like an antidote to treat patients, you know, like cats exposed to organophosphates. Pyrethrin isn't an organophosphate, okay? So maybe you'd probably say, nope, I'm not gonna use that one. Or you could be that person who's like, I don't even remember. I remember learning about it, but I don't remember what it's for. Could it be used for this? I don't know. So you, honestly, just put a question mark. You're not sure, put a question mark and keep it moving, okay? The last option that we have is methylcarbamol. Okay, so I really hope you would remember what this one's for, but if you don't, methylcarbamol is a muscle relaxer that is used in veterinary medicine to help treat muscle tremors, okay? So if you are gonna have a hard time remembering methylcarbamol, just think methylcarbamol, like M, muscle. I mean, it's kind of vague, but hopefully after watching this video, it'll stick in your head, all right? So methylcarbamol, we know, hopefully, or at least now, that, you know, that drug is used to treat muscle tremors because it is used as a muscle relaxant. Now, remember the other answer choice that we said could be true, could be correct, acepromazine? If I had to pick between acepromazine that is used to sedate, relax, tranquilize, versus methylcarbamol, which I know works on the muscles directly to do what I need it to do, which is to stop the tremors, then I am going to pick methylcarbamol as my option, okay? That is going to be the best answer choice given what I have. So I hope that one makes sense. Okay, so the last question that we're going to do has nothing to do with a cat or dog. It's actually ferret related, okay? So I will tell you guys right now, I am not the strongest when it comes to exotics, okay? A lot of these questions outside of cats, dogs, and horses and cows, you know, have to do with fish and ferrets and some rabbits. So I'm not the strongest. Because I'm not the strongest there, I made it a point when I was prepping for the exam to focus on high yield diseases and those exotic categories, okay? High yield, and then I just prayed to God that everything else worked out. because honestly, high yield information is what the NAVLE focuses on anyway. Yes, they'll throw in some little random things here and there, but they know that people aren't specializing in ferrets. No offense to people who love them, no offense, but what I'm saying is majority of the questions have to do with cats, dogs, and then of course our farm animals and things like that, and not many on ferrets. So they know that, and for that reason, they're not gonna, you know, hit you with like 1,000 different questions pertaining to ferrets. So for me personally, I just decided to focus on the high yield information, high yield diseases that pertain to, say, fish and ferrets and things like that, and then put all of my energy into focusing on the cats and the dogs and the horses and the cows and the goats. So the question is, a 4-year-old female ferret presents with a history of an enlarged vulva and truncal alopecia. What is the most likely diagnosis? I'm trying to just remember the things that I learned about ferrets, all the, you know, the common diseases that they had. So how I would approach this question is definitely sigmoment. So it's a female ferret. And then looking at the clinical signs, enlarged vulva and the truncal alopecia, that should raise alarms in your head for something metabolic of sort, okay? So I'm gonna go through my answer choices. And before I even go through my answer choices, honestly, if I literally had this question during my exam, I would probably write down ferrets, insulinoma, adrenal gland tumor or something, because those are the two common diseases that I can recall off the top of my head that afflict ferrets. So hypothyroidism is the first answer choice. Adrenal tumor is the second answer choice. Insulinoma is the third, and Sertoli cell tumor is the fourth. Okay. Hypothyroidism, I'm probably not really gonna consider that one too much because, number one, I don't recall any connection with ferrets and hypothyroidism. I'm not saying they don't get it, but I'm saying I don't recall, so I'm not gonna put too much energy into it, especially since it's the first answer choice that I've only gone through, and I have a few others to consider. So if I'm sitting here like, okay, well, why am I gonna cross it off? I'm gonna say, well, I don't remember like dogs who have hypothyroidism, you know, presenting with enlarged vulvas or anything like that. So, probably not. So I'm just gonna cross it off the list and just keep it moving. The next one is adrenal tumor. Remember what I said, when I first think of ferrets and diseases, I think adrenal tumor and I think insulinoma. So I'm gonna put a question mark next to that one, okay? Even if I don't remember everything that happens with adrenal tumors in ferrets, I just know it's a common disease that they experience, so I'm just gonna put a question mark and move on. All right, insulinoma as my third option, sure, I can certainly put a question mark. And then let me just keep it moving. I don't want to think too much, clock is ticking, it's a ferret. I have millions of other questions to answer that will give me more points. So I'm just gonna keep going. So the last one is Sertoli cell tumor. We're talking about a female. The female we know does not have testes, at least in the question to say that she does. So I'm just not even gonna consider it. I'm not even gonna consider it. So that leaves me with adrenal tumor and insulinoma. Now, again, without remembering all the details, right off the top of your head, insulinoma, typically they present comatose, like in a comatose state or something like that, right? I don't recall, and hopefully you wouldn't either, them experiencing any hair loss like that or like enlarged vulvas. You know, it is metabolic in nature, but it's not really quite fitting in the like 15 seconds that I need to fit. Okay, so I'm just immediately gonna cross off the list because my clock is ticking and I have other questions I need to answer that will bring me more points, all right? So the adrenal tumor is the best answer choice for me, and I hope it is for you, and it is actually the correct answer. So again, this is one of those questions that are answered by people like me who maybe don't know too much about ferrets, you know, and then you just need to focus on what you know off the top of your head and also use some strategy, okay? Okay guys, so this wraps up another video. Let me know if there's anything in particular that you would like for me to cover. Until then, I will see you all next time. Bye!